5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Sasquatch Chronicles, a place where people share their encounters. Let's start the show. Ah, that's nice. One of my favorite songs from the 80s. Welcome to the show, everyone. Thanks for being here tonight. Got a great show planned for you tonight. Going to be speaking with Justin. And Justin's encounter is interesting. It's like I always tell people, be careful what you wish for, because you might just get it. And Justin's going to share his encounter tonight. I thought about having all the guys on from this particular encounter, but then there'd be five of us all trying to talk and I guess maybe if I had like a studio I invited people to, it would definitely be easier to kind of control mics and everything like that. Not that any of that technical stuff, you guys care about that. But sometimes it's tough. The more people you get on the show, the harder it is to control who's talking over who. So I invited Justin from this particular encounter. He was out with a bunch of his college buddies and just having fun, you know, going out, quote unquote, looking for Bigfoot. More or less just having fun with his buddies, and then they actually ran into one of the creatures. It's a very interesting encounter, and there's a lot of warnings in the encounter. You know, be prepared when you go out, because you never know what you might run into. If you've had an encounter and you'd like to be on the show, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. I'd love to hear about your encounter. I'd love to speak with you. Again, it's wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. If you get a chance, check out the website, sasquatchchronicles.com. Become a member, support the show, get additional shows. I sure appreciate you guys listening tonight. Hope your Sunday night's going well. Let's jump into it tonight. I want to welcome Justin to the show. Justin, thanks for coming on, man. Thanks for being here.
Hey, Wes. It's good to be here.
And if you would, just kind of start from the beginning. Tell us what you're out doing, and then if you would, just kind of walk us into the encounter.
Sure. It was a couple of years back, about 3-4 years or so ago. Was in college. A buddy of mine we had done a couple of just different trips. We enjoyed night hiking and going out, and we both were interested in the subject of Bigfoot. I'd been for a long time just kind of doing my own just like side research and stuff. I was in anthropology in college and was really interested in Native American culture and studied a lot of those things. And a lot of that, in a lot of the cultures and a lot of the places that we were reading on, I would always do side things and I'd find a lot of different names, a lot of different background stories and things like that. So it was always intriguing to me, like with so many different Native American cultures from like Alaska all the way down to Florida, just had names for it and had stories of it. And it wasn't just like a folklore. It was part of the wildlife. It was part of the everyday, sometimes part of just to watch out for, or it might be just something that was just in the forest that they dealt with or avoided. But it was interesting. So like a lot of just different stuff that was intriguing for me and growing up and then into college and stuff. So we, a buddy of mine, we'd go out to see, we'd just go out and just see what we, from amateurs. So we'd, you know, just from what we'd read or what we'd watch or just from people we know would tell us. So we'd do like knocks or calls or most of the time, nothing, just, we're just out. And for us, it was just good time to, hang out. But if anything was to happen, sweet, we're kind of just looking and seeing what we could find if there was anything out there. And, so we, into college or so, into like our junior year of college, some people in our group of friends found out we were doing those kind of things, and two of the guys on the hall asked if they could come with us next time we went out. My buddy and I, we had gone out to the Poconos in Pennsylvania a few times. We'd had some ambiguous things. Mike had, my buddy, had a sort of his own experience where he had saw something tear up the side of one of the mountainsides that we were walking through. We were in a valley and we'd heard some rustling and moving and things like that, but I didn't see anything for that aspect, but he saw something just tear up the side of the hill. And we investigated further. We found some footprints in the snow. They're really hard to make out. There were not definitive toes or anything. It was kind of more of an ambiguous thing. We just kind of took pictures and compared sizes and things like that. So it was, but nothing major, but we had enough that we decided we were going to do the Poconos again, just because that's where, if we had any sort of activity, that was someplace that we recognized and knew. So that's kind of what we decided to do. So we took these two guys that just, they talked to us. I had talked to them about Bigfoot, and they were just interested in it, and they were like, yeah, we'll go out. So we decided we'd all go out on a Friday or Saturday night. We went out. Drove out to from our school to the Poconos area that we had picked out. So we went out there and we made, just kind of showed them the ropes. We hiked in. We parked the car. We hiked in a little ways. Came up to a valley area that we had been to before, that kind of overlooked kind of a valley, and it was in between some power lines. So it was kind of like a stretch where you could just have some open side and then forest and then more trails. So we just kind of showed them the ropes. We just made a few calls. We listened. We just kind of sat around. We made a couple knocks. We had a really kind of silly moment happen where we were hearing these like pops off in the distance. We weren't quite sure what it was, and it turned out to be firecrackers, and the guys were pretty excited, but it turned out to be nothing. So we kind of laughed that off and continued our night. We just kind of walked the trails, listening. And then probably around like midnight or so, we heard some ATVs coming, and or to the sound of ATVs driving up a trail. We kind of panicked, and we're not quite sure. It might have been like state or forest. We just weren't sure, so we kind of just booked it and ran back to as fast as we could back to the car. And we kind of just, kind of being college kids, just kind of took off without really thinking about anything else other than that. But the night was still young. They wanted to stay out. We weren't kind of done. So we had looked at a spot earlier, and we kind of just put it into an old GPS I had, and drove out a little ways past to this area. In the area of like the Bear Creek, where we decided to go. And we kept driving. We found kind of some, using the GPS, we kind of found some like more of the back roads, took some ways in. We kind of got some way out there, a couple miles in, past like maybe one, two houses, and that was about it. They were pretty out in rural Pennsylvania. We found a nice area where we just figured we could pull over. We pulled over to the side of, with some sign that had I think what we basically like a makeup of a trail, but it was pretty much nothing of a trail. And we got out. We got out of the car. We just were walking up and down the road a little bit. They wanted to try out a call, so we let them, and we just listened. And we were out there for probably a little while. And Mike and I decided we were just going to just let out one of my favorite calls, one of the calls that I've been good at. Like we both took a lot of time on YouTube and just listened to a lot of recordings of just different calls that we had heard from different people that would post them, or just from just different sites, and different like the BFRO or just different websites that had for researching and stuff, the Pennsylvania Project, Bigfoot Project. And so we just would mimic those, where we just find ways of just mimicking them and honing those in. So I let out one of my whoops that we had done. So had Mike. We just listened. We just kind of sat there and listened. Not honestly really expecting to get anything. We just kind of were already out just having a fun guy night and enjoying the time. But this time we got something back. Probably like only a minute or two after the whoops were let out, and was very clear that it was almost exact same from what we were, which was the thing that struck us the most.
So whatever it was mimicking you.
Yeah. So whatever it was mimicking. So we kind of like, we were able to like distinguish that it wasn't a coyote, it wasn't a dog. It might be another person, because that can't happen and those kind of things. But so we just were, but we were listening. We were kind of, the other guys were kind of pretty excited, because it was like, whoa, this is, you know, you heard something. And I was like, what? And we didn't know what it was. So we decided to do it again, just to see if it was just like kind of our imagination getting the best of us, or if it was something else. So we let it out again. So we let out the same kind of call, and we waited, and sure enough, it happened again, the same one. So one of the guys we had brought along looked over at me and asked if he could do, or kind of like whispered, if he could do like a knock. We had brought some bats. We always carry bats with us and stuff for those kind of things. And we had, you know, heard about those different things. We don't know if it's, didn't know if it was a communication thing or any sort of way. So we just figured, why not? We'll just try it. I mean, if it's going to happen, it's going to happen. So we just tried. So he let out two knocks, just as hard as he could against one of the trees close by. It was a good ring. It had a good solid crisp sound. We just waited. We just kind of waited. And then it happened again. So this time a knock came back. So for us, it was like, okay, this is either, you know, the real deal or another person. So we kind of just were like, okay, do it again. And so our guy does it again. We wait. And then we can hear it. But this time it wasn't so faint. It was a little bit more, you could hear it. It definitely had a little bit more pack to it, the knock that we got back. So we decided to kind of make our way into the woods, just following kind of where we had heard it. We stopped. We made another one. We waited. And then we got a third one back. So we're like, so, and this time it was definitely the crisp and the loudest we'd heard it, probably the closest we'd heard it. And so we kept going in towards the sound, kind of slowly in. The night was light enough that you didn't need a flashlight, really. We could make our way through, but it was dark enough that like you just had to kind of go slow and make sure you're being safe and stuff. But this was early spring, so like there was leaves, just leftover leaves from the winter on the ground. So it wasn't ton of foliage, but in Pennsylvania, there's just always things on the ground. We're going through, and just the one thing I do, like we all remember from that night, is just like how much the forest was alive that night. Just remember, like, I remember the crickets. I remember hearing an owl or two. I remember even hearing like the raccoons calling, but like you could distinctly hear that kind of like just the nightlife. It was so distinct that night. And like it had been in a couple of different night hikes that we had been on, just couldn't deny it. So we were hiking. So we were just kind of moving our way slowly in towards kind of where we had heard the sound. And then we just kind of, we did one more knock. We didn't hear anything. We let out Mike let out a short whoop just to see. And we didn't hear anything. There was no sound. There was no response. We just kind of waited, and listened. And that's kind of when, everything kind of changed. Like we just suddenly just noticed a sudden change in like the forest and the area around us. Like it just went silent. I mean, the whole forest went quiet. Like you could hear a leaf hitting another leaf if it was like dropping from a tree. Like it was so quiet all of a sudden, which really got the hair on our backs back of our neck standing up, or for me at least, on the back of my neck standing up. And we're just listening, and we're just really in that space, like, okay, like, maybe, like, this is different, this is odd. And that's when I heard the shuffling, this kind of kind of like footsteps kind of thing. Like, the it would go a couple spaces and then stop, and then it would, and then we'd listen, and then we'd go another couple more paces, and then it would stop. And we're just listening, following as best we can with our eyes and our ears as open as we can to the shuffling. And we kind of pinpointed where we thought the sound was coming from, or this walking, this sound was coming from. And I whispered over to Mike, and was like, I think we should just throw our flashlights out and just see if it's an animal, like if it's just an animal or something like that, whatever it is, hopefully we'll just catch it with our lights. So kind of on three, we kind of all did that kind of silent on three, and we just lit up the forest. I mean, we had, all of us just had really high LED lumen lights that we had brought, and we were just shining. I mean, that whole area that we had picked just lit up, and we saw trees and we saw bushes. It was like mixedly dense, like dense in parts and then open in others, kind of spaced. Like, there were certain places that were kind of dense, and there were places that were kind of spaced out in the tree lines. And we're just kind of panning around that little bit of area, and we're looking around. And I remember behind me there was this kind of large rock, and I decided I was going to just kind of hop on the top, just kind of like see if I could look over the brush, maybe like – maybe whatever it is underneath maybe the brush or lower, or maybe if I get a higher vantage point. I just kind of in my head was just thinking, if I could just get higher, I could maybe see something else. So I crawled up on this rock, boulder-esque, and just kept looking, and they were all looking. Everyone was just kind of silently listening, and look at the shuffling or footsteps had really just stopped at that point because the lights had come on. And so we were just panning, and it was probably a minute or two, and we didn't really see anything. And I was asking Mike to hold my flashlight so I could get back down from the rock without like tripping or falling or anything. So I knew where I was going to land when I was going to just kind of hop down. And just as I was looking up one more time to like kind of look with the light, and I was coming down from the rock, is when I just saw this like mass, this arm and this leg and this thing go from one tree to the next. And I mean, I remember my, just everything just stopped. Like, I was like, holy shit. And like, couldn't say, like, my heart had gone into my throat, my lungs. Like, I felt like my lungs had completely deflated. I couldn't breathe. I can just replay it in my head in slow motion over and over and over again. This like arm swinging with a body, just moving from one tree to the next. It was a very short, quick motion. Just remember the hair, the hand, the leg, the butt. Like, you can see, like, you can actually like see a butt, and you could see like a foot and a leg. So that's really what I got. Like, there was no head. I really saw like probably like the back of the head, like no face or anything like that. No real like chest or anything. Most of that had already must have already gone past like into the next tree. But I just remember that arm like just swinging to go behind the tree, and the leg stepping behind the tree, and that whole like just kind of back.
How big do you think the thing was? I mean, how tall?
I would say, because I'm 6 foot tall, and I was getting down from the rock, and the rock probably gave me like another like couple inches, five maybe. So, and I think at that point when I was getting down from the rock, I was level with its head. So I would put it probably at like, I don't know, 6'5", 6'7", I would say. That's the rough estimate I would probably give it. It wasn't massive. Like, I don't remember it being massive. I actually remember it kind of being like a little on the skinnier side, honestly. Like, I saw that, like, you could see through the hair, like a little bit of the muscle. Because distance wise, this was probably 25 yards, maybe 30, like 25, 30 yards away. And just like, I can, that like the hair was long, but it was like not patchy, but enough where you could like see almost like the skin underneath the hair, if that makes sense. Like underneath with the hand, like you could see where like there wasn't hair in the hand and there wasn't hair in the foot, if that makes sense. And there was like hair things in the leg, like really, really hairy leg, but kind of make out like some of the skin. So that's like kind of like what I would say I saw. And the hair was definitely long, but it definitely had shorter aspects. Like it was longer up top and it kind of got shorter as it progressed down, like part of the arm and part of the back into like the butt area. And then like part of the leg into the foot area was definitely where it was like shorter. And then everything else was longer, I guess you could say.
So what's going through your mind at this point? You see this thing, you're climbing down from the rock. What's going through your mind at this point? Be careful what you wish for.
It's like, holy crap. I mean, and part of my mind is like, this isn't real. Like, there's no way this is like, there's no way that this could possibly happen. This is a fluke. This is an accident. This is, there's no way. Like I've always heard stories. I've always read things about it. I've seen plenty of videos. I've watched the Patty footage over and over and over again, and like detail and analysis. I mean, like, and it just doesn't, it just didn't comprehend, if that makes sense. Like, it just, it was almost like I'm scared out of my mind, but at the same time, I want to know what the heck that thing is, if that makes sense.
How did it compare to the Patterson-Gimlin film from what you saw? I mean, what was it comparable to what you saw? Or?
Like I said, it was skinnier. It was definitely like skinnier, it seemed, than Patty. Like Patty just seems a little thicker, if that makes sense. It just seemed a little bit skinnier. But everything else, like the way that the brief area of like the head from like what I drew, like it was, I'm really glad I just drew everything because it kind of brought back things that I didn't even think about. But definitely like there really wasn't a neck. There really wasn't, like I could tell at least, there wasn't really much of like a neck. Like you just basically arm swing, like back of head. And then, yeah, I just remember it, like it could see the muscle tone, like in the leg and in the arm. But I would say the main difference I would see in the Patty film is that it just was a little skinnier, just smaller, just kind of that kind of thing. Like that's what it just seemed like. If I could compare it to that, I would say that's really what I would describe.
And so what happens next?
Mike is looking at, like, we're all looking in that direction. I saw something, I can barely make it out, but I'm trying to tell the guys, like, there, it's in that tree. It's that tree kind of thing. Like, and one of the guys wants to get a different angle on it. He, without really saying much, he's just like, he just turns on kind of his phone, looks at, like, says, like, turn on your phone. And he's like, I'm just going to go here, but I'm going to keep my phone on. And I'm just going to try to see if I can get a different angle on it. Really, before we can even say anything, he's kind of already doing it. That's kind of how this kid is. He was very impulsive. No one else really, I don't think, saw what I saw. Like they were just like, you saw it. So they're all now wanting to go forward and see this thing. And we're talking about like just some, this is like kind of like, I look back and this is the stupidest college moment, kind of like these kids. Mike is armed with like his crazy like hatchet sucker. We got bats and a couple knives. Like we're not prepared for anything like that, but they want to see it. And I'm kind of in the same place, like adrenaline's pumping through my body and I need to see this thing again. Like, I need to know that I was like, it wasn't my imagination. It wasn't my imagination. I saw something actually in the flesh. And so we're making our way. We're inching. I mean, it feels like an eternity and we're probably just inching piece by piece by piece. And it's probably only a few minutes, but I mean, it just felt like forever. So we're inching closer and closer to this tree. And the only thought that's going through my head is either this thing is going to bolt and we're all going to see it, or we're going to come on around this tree and it's going to be right there and we're still going to see it. And at that point, I don't know what we would do at that point. Yeah. So we're just, I don't know. So like, it's weird. We're all kind of close, shoulders to shoulders, and we're moving forward closer and closer and closer. And I remember this is like kind of that moment where kind of everything changes. I hear like either just a grunt or a, but also like a snap of a tree or a snap of a branch. like when I've talked to my buddies, that's what also they remember. They just remember this loud snap to our, like completely to our 9 o'clock, like totally to our left, to our 9 o'clock. And just instinctually, we all pan our flashlights to where we heard the sound. And at that point, I don't think any of us were thinking anymore. We just kind of were all on this, like our sound sensories, like whatever our senses are picking up, that's where we're just kind of going. And I remember panning my flashlight to the left with at least Mike, maybe the other Josh and the other guy. And there are these eyes. I mean, we just panned to our left and it's just like eye shine. These, and this was much higher off the ground, than the other ones. I'd say the eyes were probably, they were small. They weren't huge, but they were, you know, enough that would grab your attention. Probably greenish yellow, I would say, somewhere in that vicinity, of color. And it was high off the ground. I mean, I was using a branch that was on the side of this large tree, kind of to scale it. And so we're just kind of, I said, eye shine. Mike's saying eye shine. I'm like, do you see it? He sees it. And so in my head, I'm just saying, okay, like there's a branch there. It could be a possum. It could be a raccoon. It could be an owl. Like there's a branch there. Let's try to be like, we're all kind of on edge. Let's just, in my head, I'm kind of just trying to process and figure out like, maybe let's just try to keep it up. But then that's when basically the whole thing or body, like you can just, where the eyes move from go behind the tree without bouncing or moving. Like if an animal is moving across a tree or like a raccoon or a possum or something like that, like they might move, but you'll see like a little bit of like the bobbing, or you'll see something like where they might turn their head briefly to look where they're going and then turn back to look at you.
Now, when you guys are shining the lights on it, are you only seeing the eyes shine at this point?
Yeah. I mean, I think we're just glued on these eyes. I mean, at just the whole, it's almost as if our flashlights just get sucked into this darkness. I mean, just this darkness just is enveloping our flashlights, but just the eyes are there. And I don't know if it's just because that's what we're all of us are high alert. We're just glued to these eyes. But that's all I remember. I just remember like a black mass and eyes, like darkness. And it's odd because like there was light. I mean, there was like good stars and things like that. Like you would think like there would be something more, but I think the scariest part about it is that it was just like our flashlights just were enveloped in this black, I don't know, just darkness. And then there were these two eyes, these like glowing clean yellow eyes just staring back at us. And they're moving. And they're moving like behind the tree, then poking back out, like leaning out. And then it would go back behind the tree. Those eyes would go back behind the tree. And then it would poke back out, like almost like not, like just kind of leaning out. And we were just fixed. And I was just fixed on these eyes. And the crazier thing, I think that changed the game for me, that it wasn't like an animal that could be perched on the tree, is that it went to the other side of the tree. And then the eyes moved from one tree to the next. And those eyes never stopped looking at us. It floated. It was almost as if those eyes were just floating. Like there was no, it was as if like the eyes were just floating in from one tree to the next. And it would go behind the tree. And then it would look out and peek around and then go back behind the tree. And then it would peek out. And then it would go to the next tree over to the right from our left. And they just floated. I mean, we just followed them for two, three more trees of just, and we have completely forgotten about what I saw that was to our now, you know, like 12 o'clock. And it's the craziest thing. Like, it's almost like we were just in this trance, like just this, our heart, like my heart is racing. I'm just fixed on these eyes, going from one tree to the next tree to the next tree until finally it's just gone. I mean, the tree, they go behind one tree and then it doesn't peek back out. And we're just glued to this tree waiting. And it felt like forever. It was probably only like a minute or two, but it felt like forever in this moment that we're in. And then just as if nothing had happened, the forest just comes back to life. We hear the crickets slowly start to come back. You hear just the sound of just animals again. You hear the sound of an owl again, like just as if like nothing had happened. They're just like, it just slowly, almost like someone had turned the volume back up on a radio to like full, from like mute, or from zero to, you know, 20. Like it just like, you just see everything. You just could hear everything come back to life. And we just kind of almost like snapped out of it. It was almost like we snapped out of it at that point. And we're like, what? And then we just booked it back to the car. We weren't thinking about anything else. We just, like all of us just instinctually ran back to the car. I don't even know when our buddy who had like gone off to like get a better view at some point, like he was next to us staring at the eyes too. It was, but we all four of us, we just ran back to the car. We got in the car, just completely silent. I had this like weird, like monster movie fear suddenly that I was going to turn on the car and the lights were going to come on. There was going to be this monster just staring at us from like, from the high beams that we turned on from the car or whatever, if that makes sense. But like just on high edge. Like I was just like, what am I going to, like, are they just going to be at the car? Like, what, are we just going to have a hand come through or something at us? I just didn't know when I got in the car and we just sat there. I mean, I don't think we turned on the car and it just sat there. I mean, I think all of us just sat there in silence. Didn't know what to say. Didn't know what to think. I finally just put the car into drive and we just started driving back down the road we had come from. And, I think it was a couple hours. We had at least a 2 or 3 hour drive back to the college. But I mean, I think it wasn't until like, I don't know, an hour after the drive, we started kind of like talking about what was like one of the guys pitched up like, okay, what the heck was like, what the heck just happened? I don't know, man. Like, and we were talking about the different things. Like I was telling them what I saw and they were telling me what they saw. And I was talking about the eyes and we're talking about like, do you see like anything else other than that? And just kind of going from there. And I don't remember if it was Mike. I don't remember if it was one of the other guys, but someone just basically said like, no one's going to believe us. And it was just kind of like, then everyone just kind of was silent again. Like I was like, yep. Yeah. There's no way anyone's going to believe us kind of thing. But it was solidifying because at least the four of us knew that like we were coming out of this at least in one piece, but also coming out of this, like knowing that no matter what it was going to be. And so we got back to, you know, got back to college and everyone kind of went their separate ways to their rooms. I tried to sleep. I think I slept a little bit and then it was the next day. And, you know, some people had, you know, heard about us had gone. They're like, so did you see anything? And like, kind of like joking around. And it was really hard to kind of say, yeah or no. I don't mind talking to people about it. Like if they want to, I'm really open. Like I really don't mind. I think it's something that is real and I know it's real. And if people want to have conversation with me about it, I'm willing to talk. And if they have questions, I'll do my best. Or if I don't know, I point them in the right direction or say, I don't know. And I mean, it's just one of those things that I think if people aren't talking about it, it's not really going to get resolved or get changed.
I tend to agree with you on that. I think that if people have encounters, they should come forward. And, you know, like I said, be careful what you wish for. You know, you can go out and find these things. It's not impossible to find them. And sometimes when you're actually looking for them, you do find them. Probably with all the noise and everything you guys were making, it probably decided to come in and check you guys out, see what you guys were doing, and then it backed away. And, you know, the behavior is interesting. I've noticed when there's two or more people, these things tend not to, most of the time, tend not to be quite as aggressive. If there's a group of people, you know, if there's just one, it's usually a different story. But if there's a group like you guys, that, I mean, it shows you how smart they are. They're not stupid. They're not going to pick a fight that they could potentially lose. Now, could it go through and could have slaughtered all four of you? Absolutely. But it might have got hurt in that process. I mean, you guys are carrying weapons. I realize they're not guns, but you guys are carrying weapons and something comes at you and you're going to start, you know, chopping away.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, that's what my buddy swears he'll never go out in the woods again without one, without a gun. I'm pretty darn close. Like, I love the outdoors and I love hiking. I've gone multiple camping trips. I live in Maine now and just, I love Maine. And Maine is gorgeous and, been out camping, but even then I'll just in quiet. I won't tell anyone, but it's just kind of my way of keeping my conscience, but also everyone around me safe, whether it's family or friends. I just, it's kind of my silent thing. I definitely, since I've been out in the woods and since that experience, I've definitely been checking my six more and watching around and just kind of being more self-aware of things. But I've definitely tried not to let it stop me from going out and doing things, like whether it's hiking or camping or hunting or doing whatever it is. I mean, like, it's just, I don't want it to stop me from being that place, but I also want to, it's a sobering thing too, just to kind of,
to realize these things are real.
Yeah, really. To kind of definitely, I always, that belief then becoming more of like a reality, if that makes sense.
Yeah. You always kind of, you know, some people I've heard, you know, they assume that these things are out there or they believe that these things are out there. But once you see them, it's completely different. It becomes real. It gets real really quick. You know, if that thing would have gotten aggressive, it could have gotten real, real quick.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and I think it's a scary thing that we all look about. Like, it's kind of the situation that it could have gone the other way. And very thankful it didn't. And we're all very thankful it didn't. But it definitely is fuel. It's like that weird, sick obsession that comes with it, though. Like, I didn't fully, like, I feel like I didn't entirely, I saw one and I've seen different things, but like, you almost like want more to like solidify it. You almost want to do it again. And we did. I mean, I think a month or two later, we tried to find a similar spot and go out there and nothing, we didn't get anything that time. And we tried a different spot and almost got shot by rednecks. I mean, like and things have changed. We've all graduated out and we've moved in our separate ways. But we always keep in touch and get together for different activities or trips. But I mean, we always come back to like talking about that. Like, remember that time? And then we just kind of like, yeah. And then we just kind of sit in it.
Yeah. You guys will be tied to the hip until you guys die. You know, it's something all of you experienced. I think it's interesting too, their behavior, which I always find fascinating. I almost think that these things don't realize we as humans struggle to see at night. You know, we don't have, and when I say that, I mean, like, we don't have night vision like a lot of predators do.
Yeah.
And I don't think that these things realize that. I don't think they realize we really can't see that well at night. And, you know, it's interesting, its behavior, how it kind of cautiously looked around the tree, kind of went back. You know, it didn't really expose itself. It didn't jump out in the open at you guys, or could have probably turned its head, crawled down, and crawled away, but it's still observing you guys. And I just think that behavior is fascinating.
Oh, agreed. I think, and it's, I don't know if it was our, like, how intense our flashlights were or like that kind of thing too. Like, but I have no idea. I agree. I think in reading, and I've also, you know, listening to your show and listening to other people's encounters and stories and stuff and the behavior that they exhibit, is just, I think, something that's, it's hard for us to wrap our minds around, especially for like, in, for me, even like I've, you know, I've been a lover of like animals and studying, like I was supposed to go to college for zoology and kind of took a different path, but like, I've always, been fascinated with animals and behavior and what goes on. This is just a whole nother, just seems like a whole nother can of worms. Like, it just doesn't quite fit into any specific, I don't know, like, category. Like, you can't just like kind of, you can't just put it, okay, this is like, it's just like bears, you know. You can put it right next to like the bears. Okay. It's omnivore. It you know, has a hibernation or a hiking thing. Oh, well, maybe it's more like maybe a wolf or a cougar where it's loner and it stalks alone and works together. Oh no, it's a family group. Okay. Maybe it's in more of the, you know, ape line. We can put it in like ape behavior and stuff, but more from a North American standpoint. So it's like really hard to like put it in one category.
It's very hard to place it. It's very, very hard to place it. You know, sometimes they act like chimps. Sometimes they act like apes. Sometimes they act like people.
Yeah.
And it's odd because there's not a whole lot of creatures you can put into that category. I mean, I guess great apes can act like people. Mm-hmm. They will show human-like traits. But with these things, I mean, it's so odd. And then you get in different parts of, I know, like here in the United States, you get in different parts of it, and it's their behavior is night and day. Either they're more aggressive or they're more pissed off in one area. And then, you know, especially on the East Coast, you hear more, not quite as aggressive type behaviors. And the other thing, too, is a lot of people describe the proportions, not always, but not, I would say, more human-like in proportion. And when I say that, like out here in the Pacific Northwest, a lot of people will say, well, their arms were, you know, hanging down past the knees or like an ape.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
But sometimes out on the East Coast, again, not always, sometimes you get those weird reports where it's like, no, it was kind of proportioned like a person. I mean, it didn't move like a person. That could be people's perspective too. But with all of your anthropology classes, what do you think this thing is? I mean, I know you're saying it's hard to place it somewhere, but where would you place it? What do you think this thing is?
So completely from looking at like the kind of the Native American like kind of aspects, a lot of times they see it very much like as another animal in the forest, or as another, you know, creature of the night or creature that moves around. And sometimes you see it as like a giant or a forest person like aspects, or attributing that. And that's a lot of that, I think, with how we as humans interpret to animals and we put ourselves in that aspect, in that category. I think I would definitely lean more, honestly, to more of like a great ape or an ape that crafts, not in the sense of Gigantopithecus, but possibly something that in that lineage divulged and came across the land bridge and those kind of things. But if it happened to be something in the homogeneous area, and like with some form of thing like a Heidelbergensis or something like that, like the tall man, or something similar to that, it wouldn't surprise me. But I definitely, honestly, like more move over, I would say ape. I would say more ape, just with behavior and the stories that I've heard and listened to and accounts, and then also just watching. But they're definitely smart. I mean, they definitely don't fit into all the categories. There's definitely things that make them different, like language aspects, like listening to the Sierra sounds and listening to different chatter and that kind of stuff that goes on too. Like there's definitely, like if you listen to chimps, like chimps have chatter. Like chimps will, you know, have those chattering things also amongst themselves too. But it definitely is more developed. Maybe that's a better word to describe it.
I would agree with you on that. I definitely agree with you on that.
And I think that's really where it comes into. I think if it is, it's just more, it's more developed, better at what they do. I forget who did it, but they did a really good job of like explaining gigantism in North America over during the Great Land Bridge, and then describing all the different animals that came over like from Asia to North America. And because of the lack of predators, prey got bigger. And because prey got bigger, predators got bigger. So you look at like the lions that were here over during the Ice Age, and things were huge. Same thing with like the flat-nosed bear that was the flat-nosed cave bear they found skulls and things in Alaska that were, you know, twice the size of Kodiak. I mean, and then we also have like woolly mammoths and stuff like that. So he had a really interesting theory on like some of the apes that might have come over and how they might have been able to develop and get better at hiding and better at maneuvering and avoiding predators and avoiding things and being able to hunt and do things, but also being able to like escape and maneuver and get better. I mean, if they've been here for as long as the tribes and different stories and things that have dated back as far as it goes and as far as writing has gone, and even like cave paintings and those things that we've seen, I mean, they've had a long time to figure things out and make living and survival key.
Yeah, no, I tend to agree with you. It's hard to place these things. It really is hard to place them. I'm with you on that. When you hear about other people's encounters and you really start looking into this, I mean, even the tracks that they leave, the feet, are very human-like.
Yeah, absolutely. That's like the biggest loop.
Yeah, and you look at it, and you're just like, this does not make sense. Like, this thing should not exist. That's why I don't really jump on science too much when they don't come open arms looking into this subject, because even for people in the subject, it doesn't make sense. This thing really shouldn't exist.
Mm-hmm.
And what it is, I couldn't really tell. I mean, like I always say, I don't have one in my garage I'm studying, but it's really hard to know where exactly to place this thing in our world. And it's interesting, too, when you start looking at, like, the Chinese urine or Yowie in the Outback.
Yep, and then the Yeti in Nepal and the Arain Pendek in India, on the NDS border. So they've got different terms and descriptions for them. Like, some of them have the differences, but it also looks like it's, like, environment, too. It seems like also, like, the environment shapes.
Absolutely.
How they developed or how they work with those kind of things. Like for Yeti, you see it more in the mountainous terrain, so it's bigger, it's muscular, it has kind of a size to it, so it can move through the snow and maneuver and things like that. With the Arain Pendek in the jungles, it's kind of smaller, but still has that kind of strength and maneuverability to get around it. Like, so you just kind of see that with the different descriptions you see too.
Yeah, and even here in the United States, you know, in more remote areas, you hear, like out here in the Pacific Northwest, they seem to be bigger. Even up in Canada, I had a guy that I'm going to try and get on the show who had an encounter, and he's talking about, I think it was 20 or 21-inch tracks. I'll have to call it back.
Oh, wow.
The thing he sent me, and he casted them, and they're good tracks. They're really good tracks. And he was talking about his encounter, but he was talking about how physically large this thing was. I think it was like 9.5 feet tall, and he was in shock. He just couldn't believe how big this thing was. But I tell you this to tell you, to make my point, is it seems like you get into more remote mountainous regions here in the Pacific North or in the United States, and they tend to be larger, or the reports you get from people that they're larger. I know it wasn't easy for you coming on the show. I really do appreciate you taking the time to tell the encounter. I know you've been kind of holding it, not really wanting to come on, and you know, like most witnesses, it's tough to get them to come on, but I really do appreciate you taking the time to come on and share the encounter.
Yeah, no problem. I mean, I think if more people start, you know, talking about it and having those kind of conversations, it'll create more dialogue for people that might not want to hear it, but, or might be, you know, on edge, but want to hear more about it and actually have good dialogue. I think the more we talk about it, I think that's going to honestly be the key, because we've got plenty of footprints. We've got plenty of everything out, like hair and fecal and every saliva. People have got plenty of other things, but it's the witnesses and the things that people have seen that I think are the insurmountable evidence that really point to this. This really is hard pressed to be a hoax.
No, you're right. And be careful what you wish for. If you go out looking, you might run into it, you know?
Yeah, definitely holding back on, what I do when I'm out there and who I'm with and stuff. But I always have my eye open, trying to find, and anytime videos come out, I try to like just look and see. It's that kind of thing. I think it's more of for now, and what I think is it's the niche of my back is just like the do I really want to have seen a face? Because I've heard plenty of stories of people have seen them, and it's just different descriptions and things, or like a full body, like seeing one in the daytime or one at like night, but it's like really up close. It's like, do I really want that? I don't know. So it's like that kind of those aspects. I don't know if I really want to, but I think I'd rather be prepared for anything than not to be.
Yeah. And there's nothing wrong with going out again and looking. I mean, I think most people have an encounter, even a scary encounter. Once you time helps heal things, you almost kind of want to go back and go, God, I want to see that again. What was that? Did that really happen? Did I really experience that? It seems like a dream when you go back and think about your own encounter, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. I've been to now that I live in Maine, I've gone to the International Cryptozoology Museum that Lauren Coleman, I don't know if you know who Lauren Coleman is, but cryptozoologist, I got to meet him in person with my buddy Mike. We actually went together to this place just because it was fun and we were excited, and we actually got to meet him and talk to him, and he got to show us like the footprints that have been taken, casted in Maine, and showing us like the different sightings that have been going on in Maine. And if we ever wanted to look, these are the places to check out. And then he also was the one that encouraged us to draw and like write our encounters down. He really encouraged us to like really make that, because
That kind of makes it solidifies and brings back memories that you might not even have remembered. And it did, honestly, for drawing. I think that's really the thing that like freaked me out the most was when I started drawing. And it's not great. I'm not a great artist, but like it still brought back like kind of those sudden memories. And it kind of became more, honestly, more solidified, I think, in my mind.
Yeah.
Of what it was. But yeah, definitely keeping an eye out. Catan's got places. And every time I go out to Washington, I'm always like itching to get out there and hiking and stuff. I got family and out there, and getting out of Washington is always a fun place.
Keep me up to date, will you? Let me know if anything else happens, or if you're out there and something else happens. Please keep me up to date, and thank you again for coming on.
Yeah, no problem. I'll send you an email or something.
Thanks, Justin. And that's it for tonight, everyone. Remember, if you've had an encounter, shoot me an email. Wes@SasquatchChronicles.com. If you get a chance, check out the website, SasquatchChronicles.com. Become a member, help support the show. Thanks, everyone, for listening. I will see you guys next time.
Something acquired.